Clownfish, clownfish. Bitchcock, bitchcock. Clownfish, clownfish. Bitchcock, bitchcock.
Oh, all you beautiful boys and girls, and all of those in between. My name is Melina Bitchcock, and I want to welcome you to another fabulous episode of Bitch Talk with Bitchcock, a queer talk show where I interview some of the best queer performers from all over. I'm so excited because once again, that's right, we are jumping into the world of burlesque. Yes, baby. Nothing is more titillating than the art of tease. And I'm so excited because we have a mask presenting burlesque performer today. One of my favorites here in Eugene, Oregon, the one and only Pippin.
Hello, Melina. It's so great to be on your show.
Oh my God, I'm so happy to have you here. And can I say, you look quite dashing today. Yes. Well,
thank you. And you look absolutely fabulous as usual.
Oh, stop it some more. I always say a man looks better when he has a shirt off.
I would agree with that.
Well, honey, how have you been surviving this last year?
I mean, I haven't really been performing except for occasional online performances. Personally, I've been doing pretty well. I've been one of the fortunate ones who could work remotely. And so my life hasn't really changed except I never leave my bedroom. And most of the time I spend here in front of the green screen in front of my computer.
Oh, I love that. I mean, who doesn't love a little green screen action? You could just go visit everywhere, you know, visit a trip to Hawaii, maybe go to Egypt.
Oh, I do. And you should see some of the beautiful houses I've been living in.
Oh, my goodness. So luxurious. Well, my love, I'm so excited because you're a multi-talented person, but one of the reasons I know you is from doing the fabulous art of burlesque. Are you ready to dive into the bulk of this interview?
Absolutely, Melina. Let's dive in.
Oh. So what was your first exposure to the art of burlesque itself?
I did my first burlesque show at the tender age of 55.
Oh my goodness, I love that.
In the years prior to auditioning for Unveiled, Eugene's Queer Burlesque, I was performing in talent shows doing raunchy Broadway parody songs, mostly Broadway, some popular music, and I wanted to do more of that, and so I saw auditions for Unveiled, Eugene's Queer Burlesque, and I thought, well, I've never really done burlesque, but I have my songs. So I auditioned with one of my parody songs, a parody of My Favorite Things from Sound of Music, very raunchy. And I took my clothes off while I sang it. I learned later that burlesque is more than just taking your clothes off on stage. There is a whole art to that. And in the 4 years or so that I performed with Unveiled before the pandemic, I got to try a lot of different kinds of burlesque, nerdlesque, boylesque, as well as doing my parody songs, which might be what I'm best known for.
I love that. We'll definitely get more into those parody songs a little bit later. Now, tell me about that first time on stage. Were you nervous going out there, even though you knew you were going to be singing, but like, were you nervous going out there knowing you're going to maybe be taking it all off in front of everyone?
I wasn't nervous about being unclothed on stage. When I was a freshman in college, I was in a campus musical theater production of Hair. And so I was naked on stage in front of 300 people for 14 performances. After that, I found it very difficult to find any kind of modesty inside of myself. So it wasn't that. It was... Now, grew up doing musical theater. And so I'm used to singing and dancing at the same time. I wasn't used to singing, dancing, and disrobing all at the same time. And I realized it requires a level of rehearsal that goes far beyond anything that I needed for ordinary musical theater. And so many of my early attempts at burlesque were really awkward. Fumbling to get the pants off my legs and zippers and snaps that I hadn't rehearsed well enough with. So it's been a long learning experience.
Well, once you dived into the deep end, let's say, of burlesque, what was it about burlesque that kept you attracted to it?
Really the origins of burlesque. So burlesque comes from a Italian word, which I don't know what the word is, but it means to mock or to make fun of.
Yeah.
And that's the essence of what I'm doing with parody songs. Also, I was familiar with the history of burlesque and how it grew out of vaudeville, and in its early days was really like a raunchy vaudeville. It was more than just striptease. There were musical acts and comedy acts and a lot of the same kinds of things that you would find in a vaudeville show. It was just geared towards a more adult audience.
Right.
And so I kind of felt like I was sneaking into burlesque under the raunchy vaudeville side of it, and then once I was in it, I grew to love burlesque, the striptease part of burlesque.
Ooh. Did you ever find the striptease itself maybe empowering?
Oh, absolutely. Ooh. Absolutely. I mean, I grew up having really horrid body image, which, yeah, is not unusual for young queer people to experience. But I think for me, it was rather amped up because I grew up in this little suburb of LA called Beverly Hills. Maybe you've heard of it.
You know, I think somewhere in a fairy tale land.
Yeah, well, most people think of it as a fairy tale land, and I kind of grew up thinking of it as a bit of a living hell. I was always the shortest boy in my class, and I was teased mercilessly for it, which was probably a good thing because they overlooked how effeminate I was and that I had a lisp, and bullies aren't very creative, and they'll go for whatever is the most obvious.
Right.
And for me, it was my height, so I got the whole panoply of shrimp, half pint, you know, the whole thing. And so I never thought of myself as sexually desirable. And when I was 17, I started going to West Hollywood, which is right next door to Beverly Hills. And I would hang out in the Unicorn Bookstore on Santa Monica Boulevard. And there I read all kinds of books on coming out and gay history, gay literature. Yeah, the magazines in the back of the store. I mean, fuck.
The naughty ones, yes.
But West Hollywood, and I've heard it joked that West Hollywood is a city of tens all searching for an 11.
That sounds about right.
Yeah, and I never thought that I measured up to the numbers, and so I always had the self-image that I was just this short, funny-looking Jewish kid. And I couldn't imagine anyone really thinking of me as hot and sexy. And that carried mostly. It improved a bit. Certainly, being in hair and being naked on stage kind of helped that. But it had been many years. It had been many years since I had been performing regularly like that when I joined Unveiled. And you know, I wasn't a 19-year-old anymore. I was 55, and to think that people could look at me and what I do on stage as being sexy or erotic was probably the most empowering experience of my coming out in sexuality. And I say coming out because in a way I still am coming out, and I don't think that process ever really stops.
Oh my goodness. Could you explain that a little bit, just to elaborate?
I can get to it more in detail, and that's what my one-man show is really all about. And I didn't want to jump in that if you're not ready to talk about that, but so I came out as gay. I later came out as, I was married to a woman for 15 years.
Oh, goodness. Scandalous.
And so I came out as bi, I guess. Now I kind of think of it more as pansexual, but a lot of those, but those terms didn't exist. Halfway through our marriage, we came out as polyamorous. And so there was that coming out. There was, after my divorce, of coming out all over again. And more recently, I discovered the term demisexual.
Oh, yeah.
And so I've been now having to come out as demisexual because that doesn't really fit very well in mainstream gay culture with, you know, with gay hookup culture.
Absolutely. For those who are watching, demisexual, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, Pippin, it's kind of similar to asexual, but a person has to have a connection with that person, a very strong connection to want to be sexual with them.
Exactly. Exactly, Malia. Yeah.
My partner is actually demi, and I try to stay very educated when it comes to demi, asexual, and all of that, because there's so many spectrums of people out there, and we just should educate ourselves on it.
Yeah, and that's why I think coming out is a lifelong process, because I love that queer people are always inventing new terms to describe different aspects of sexuality. I often think if I had had these terms when I was first coming out at 17, how much different my coming out might have been. I think there's a power in naming something, especially something as complex and nuanced as human sexuality. That, and I think sexuality is fluid and it's changing. I know it's changed for me over time. There have been times when I've been a bit more attracted to women. I was surprised to find that I've met some trans people who I'm just really attracted to. I never expected that. But I also, yeah, and so, yeah, I think it's always changing. And so we're always having to come to terms with who we are and then letting people know about it. That's the coming out part.
Absolutely. And you know, something I've learned is, you know, attraction is all about the person you're getting to know. And you know, I think the fact that we should be attracted to a man or we should be attracted to a woman, something kind of maybe we're brainwashed into from maybe early childhood. Because I think if we didn't have that pressure on us, and maybe if we didn't have that brainwashing happening, I think dating would probably be a little more easier, because I think I do identify as a non-binary gay man or gay person, but I've seen women or female presenting people who totally intrigue me. And I mean, who knows if the stars align one day and, you know, the Bitchcock said, hey.
Yeah, well, you know, Dr. Ruth used to say the most important sexual organ is the brain.
Absolutely. So back to the interview, my love. Could you tell me how you got the fabulous name of Pippin?
That actually was a nickname given to me at summer camp. So I after I graduated from college, I went back and was a counselor at the summer camp that I went to as a kid. And there was another counselor who had the same first name as me. And so on the first day of staff orientation, someone turned to me and said, hey, what's your favorite food? And I said, Pippin apples. Ooh. And she goes, Pippin! Well, the part of the conversation I hadn't heard was, wouldn't it be funny if people were named after their favorite food?
Oh, no.
And so the name just stuck, and it partly stuck because of Pippin the Hobbit in Lord of the Rings.
Okay.
And being only 5'2", that was kind of like an obvious thing to stick. And Pippin was also my favorite musical when I was in high school. And so it had kind of like a triple meaning, and I just decided that when I'm performing, that's who I want to be.
Now, you've mentioned earlier that you dabble in all kinds of burlesque style, including nerdlesque, gorlesque, and boylesque, and all of that. Do you maybe have a specific style you feel more comfortable with?
I don't think so. To me, when I do a burlesque performance, what I'm really doing at the essence of it is trying to tell a story.
Mm-hmm.
And depending what story I'm telling will dictate what I do. And so a lot of my pieces have been very political, and that gets more into nerdlesque, where I have a lot of props and costumes and costume reveals to other things. There was one show where the theme was slumber party.
Ooh, I love that.
Yeah, and so I thought, well, what's a slumber party without pizza?
Oh, yes.
And of course, you have the pizza delivery guy.
Oh, no.
And so I did a number to this obscure 70s smooth R&B song called I Can Deliver. And I did it as a classic boylesque number. The fun thing about it is that I had two pizzas and I ended up fan dancing with the pizzas.
Oh my gosh, that's amazing. I hope they were sausage.
pepperoni.
Well, still just as yummy.
Yeah, but a few years ago at BurleyCon, which is an annual national burlesque convention in Seattle, I got to perform I Can Deliver, and that was really a big hoot. And to, like, go from in 4 years from never having performed burlesque to be performing in front of the creme de la creme of burlesque in North America, and to get the kind of feedback I got from them was just so, that was like one of the greatest highs of my life.
Oh my goodness, that's fabulous. And I know BurleyCon is very popular. A lot of my burlesque friends go out there every year. And the things they tell me they learn, and, you know, a lot of them, they come back like sobbing, saying, oh my God, I learned so much and I found things out about myself. I'm like, oh my goodness, DragCon's not like that. What's going on over there at BurleyCon? So what else could we expect from a Pippin performance? You know, when I got to work with you once, I remember you doing a performance as Mr. Monopoly.
Oh my gosh, yes. That was definitely in the nerdlesque camp. as I said, I like to tell a story. And so I was Mr. Monopoly, whose real name is Uncle Pennybags, if you
Ooh,
didn't know that.
I
Little bit of
didn't.
Monopoly trivia. And Monopoly was originally developed as a game called the Landlord Game, which was supposed to teach people about the evils of capitalism. It then got co-opted by capitalist Parker Brothers, turned into Monopoly, and now is the game that we all know and love and hate. And so I did a burlesque number as the Monopoly man to Money, the Pink Floyd song.
Okay.
And from there I stripped down and I had a pair of boxers on with low denomination Monopoly money, and then
Yeah.
had a thong with high denomination Monopoly money, and then I had this big balloon of the Earth, which I played with kind of like Charlie Chaplin in The Great Dictator, and it was ended up. And I ended up deflating the balloon. And so the whole thing was about how capitalists are destroying the world, which is not necessarily what you think of when you think of the Monopoly Man. But I wanted to take it into a little bit of a dark place because a lot of the stuff I do gets political.
I mean, that's what performances are.
Well, I want to say something with my performances. I mean, yes, I want to entertain, but I also want people to go home with something that they
Wait,
may not have
absolutely.
had before.
Absolutely. Now, Pippin, you have some amazing costumes as we've seen through the years. Do you create any of them yourself, or do you just kind of buy them?
It depends. Some of them I buy, like, this. I'm not gonna make the things like this from scratch, but like that Monopoly Man, I hand sewed all of those Monopoly game board pieces on all of the clothing. I love making my own costumes, and so I will do that. I need breakaway pants, and so I'm hand sewing snaps on to clothes. Most of what I'm sewing is snaps and Velcro and hooks and fasteners and things like that. But what I've learned is that those things are really important if you're going to take them off on stage.
Oh my goodness. And I'm guessing with the art of burlesque, it's more than just taking your clothes off. There's probably a lot of planning, and there has to be an art form of like the perfect time when to take everything off. Can you tell me a little bit what goes on and what all goes into creating one of your burlesque performances?
It sometimes starts with an idea and then I'll search for a song. Sometimes it starts with a song and then I'll work on an idea. But to me, the music is what dictates what I do and what comes off when. And if it's a song that I'm singing, then I have to really think about how am I singing this while I'm dancing and disrobing. The process of designing the whole number end to end comes out in the rehearsal, but it's also dozens of hours of rehearsal for like a 3-minute number.
Right. I mean, there has to be tons of blocking, like theater term, by the way, that, I'm going to take my shirt off here and then I'm going to move and do a twirl because in burlesque, it's not necessarily about dancing. Sometimes it is, depending on what kind of performance you're doing, but sometimes it's movement more, than just dancing.
Well, movement, I mean, dancing, movement, dancing is movement to music.
Right.
And so I really do think about everything I do on stage during a number as choreography, whether it's what you might think of as dance steps or not. Even unbuttoning to the beat, to me, that's choreography as well.
Right. Now, do you do any like classic burlesque themes, like fan dances or balloon pops or anything fun like that?
I haven't done anything really classic burlesque. I mean, most of that is for is really more for female bodied, for femme presenting performers. But I did do a number in drag, which was a singing number. It was a Broadway tune called Everybody's Girl from the musical Steel Pier, and it's about essentially a slut who's proud of it.
Yes, like that already.
And I did that as, I actually have done drag, and I do have a drag persona. Her name is Sharon. Her name is Sharon Du Bois. She's a lounge singer wannabe from New Jersey. I think of her as a slut with a heart of gold.
Ooh, I love that. And do you bring her out a lot?
Not a whole lot. Every few years, there'll be a number that I'll want to do as a female character. And so I'll bring out Sharon to do that. So she's like my female presenting alter ego.
Oh, I love that. Now, you also mentioned earlier that you do a lot of parody music within your performances. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
I was raised on Broadway. I know, a gay man who loves Broadway, how cliche, but really, it wasn't my fault. I had it forced upon me. Growing up, my grandmother used to take all of us cousins to whatever age-appropriate musical there was on stage or screen. My first was Mary Poppins. I was 4 years old. And so I just grew up with it. They had cast recording albums at their house, which we would listen to and act out and dance around the living room. My parents couldn't sing worth beans. And so instead of singing me and my brother lullabies, they would put records on the little phonograph in our bedroom. And so night after night, I would fall asleep listening to Mary Poppins, yes, but Sound of Music, South Pacific, Peter Pan, My Fair Lady, Camelot, Carousel, Fiddler on the Roof, Hans Christian, I mean, on and on and on. And I knew all of these words better than nursery rhymes.
Okay.
And so when I was feeling upset, that's where I turned for comforting words. And if the words didn't fit my particular situation, I would change the words. And I think I wrote my first formal parody song at the age of 9. And I've just been writing parody songs my whole life. And, of course, in the older I got, the raunchier they would get.
Well, who doesn't love raunchy? I definitely know that we'll have a little bit of sample in just a few here, so everyone get a little taste of it. Now, out of all your performances, do you have any ones that kind of stand out as your most memorable?
Well, the number that I did for my first burlesque show was this song from this movie, The Big Gay Musical.
And I love that movie, yes.
Yeah, and I did the song, I Want to Be a Slut.
Yes, I love that song.
And I did it as a boylesque number where I stripped on stage. And at the end, there's this line, I've tattooed a target on my butt because I want to be a slut. And I had painted on my butt a target. And I turned around, faced the audience, and pulled my underwear down and bared my ass with the target on it on stage. I still love that number. And of course, the audience went wild.
Oh my gosh, that sounds so titillating. I'm loving that. And I love that song. I've always wanted to have the bravery and, well, to be able to sing to do that song, because that is such a wonderful performance. With that subject, do you feel like pop culture and politics affect your performances a lot?
I think so. I mean, you know, to the extent that Broadway is pop culture, which it seems like it used to be more than it is now. I have to admit, I have difficulty keeping up with contemporary pop culture. And so I tend to fall back on my old favorites from the golden era of Broadway and pop songs from the 60s and 70s. But I've done some more contemporary things.
Now, as a burlesque performer, sometimes we have to be a little entertaining, especially with your parodies. Do you consider yourself a funny person?
Yes, I do. Actually, I'm sorry?
So what's your sense of humor like?
I think it's probably sardonic. I like punching up. I like making fun of people in power. And I think it can be very empowering to those who have been oppressed. I also just like situational humor. So in 2007, I took a class in stand-up comedy because it's something that I had never done. And I thought, I'll try it out. And I ended up winning the 2008 Funniest Person in Eugene stand-up comedy contest.
Oh my goodness, that's exciting.
Yeah, that was really quite a thrill. And a lot of it is self-deprecating humor. I have a bit about being short. But it's self-deprecating in a way that I find self-empowering.
Okay, tell me.
Like one of my favorite lines was, all through high school, I kept waiting to get taller, but the only growth spurt I had was when I discovered my cousin's Playgirl magazines.
Ooh, and, who doesn't like that kind of growth?
And even that was more spurt than growth.
I love it.
Yeah, I had one of the judges of the stand-up comedy contest compare me to be like a cross between Woody Allen and Jerry Seinfeld.
Like, okay,
I'll take it.
That's right, boys and girls. We are going to take our first ever musical break. Pippin is going to perform some of his original parody music. Pippin, take it away, set up, and take us to a magical world.
It's about the pandemic. And of course, you know, the pandemic has been very trying for many of us. Since that COVID wind's been blowing, the pandemic's had us all afraid. So to get coronavirus slowing, my front door's become a barricade. Scruff and Grindr are on hold till the virus is controlled. Although my libido keeps on growing, it'll be a long, long time till I get laid. So, masturbation, here I come. Blow my horn and beat my drum. Take showers for hours, having a wank. each morning. At dawning, monkey's up and needs a spank. So sorry, boys, you'll have to wait while we all self-isolate. I will be my only date. Masturbation, here I come. Masturbation, here I come. Right between my palm and thumb. I'm punching the munchkin each chance I get. I'll tickle the pickle, won't stop till the sheets are wet. And so for now, this is my plight. All alone each day and night. Open up that porno site. Masturbation, here I come. It's true. It's true, there really is a home for certain folks with one Y chromosome. There is a place where gays endeavor free thrills, though I'm not saying that I think they should. It sits just to the east of Beverly Hills, West Hollywood. Everybody looks like movie stars there, and surreptitious sex is always good. The friends of Dorothy have found their Oz there, West Hollywood. West Hollywood, West Hollywood, though it makes Jerry Falwell scowl. West Hollywood, West Hollywood, the gays are on the prowl. They don't come out till hours after sundown. By sunrise, they all up and disappear. In short, you never could find as nice a neighborhood for cruising homosexuals than, yeah, West Hollywood. The twinks all get together on the west side, and in the east, the leather brotherhood. But they all wear tight jeans to show their best side, West Hollywood. West Hollywood, West Hollywood, where every day can bring you joy. West Hollywood, West Hollywood, where a man can be a boy. They all hang out on Santa Monica Boulevard, just waiting for Prince Charming to appear. In short, you never could find as nice a neighborhood for cruising homosexuals than, yeah, West Hollywood.
Pippin, you are so talented, honey. I love both of those performances. So back to the main interview, Pippin. Tell me, when it comes into creating some of these custom songs that you write, what all goes into creating them?
It usually starts with an idea. Like I want to write a song about looksism, how important looks are in gay culture. And so then I'll think about Broadway songs that might align with that, and I hit upon Popular from Wicked, which is where Glinda is telling Elphaba she needs to be more popular and how to be more popular. And I thought, okay, well, popular can, be being more attractive. And so I ended up writing a parody around that. Another one, I wrote a parody about getting older, and I did that to the tune of If I Were a Rich Man from Fiddler on the Roof. And it's it's hitting upon juxtaposition. So a lot of it is also the what I want the song to say also aligns with the context of that song in the show that it comes from.
I love it. Well, you have some amazing music, and I definitely love both of the numbers that you did for us tonight. So I want to give you a big round of applause and thank you.
Thank you so much, Milana.
You mentioned earlier in the interview that you started doing burlesque and working with a troupe called Unveiled, which was a queer burlesque group that was here in Eugene, Oregon. Can you tell me a little bit about that?
Oh, well, it was started by Ms. Muffet, who had been in Chico, California, and had been doing queer burlesque there. And so when they moved to Eugene, they decided to create a queer burlesque because they wanted to keep doing it. And they had some friends and some people that they knew and brought in on it. And they did three shows in early 2016, and then they wanted more performers in the troupe, and that's when they had auditions, which I joined, and I really missed that troupe, and I loved it because it was such a diverse group of genders and sexualities and styles of burlesque from classic to comedic, and so I finally felt like I had a home, like I wasn't so weird in what I did, even though what I did wasn't like what anyone else in the troupe did, but nothing that anyone in the troupe did was like anything that anyone else in the troupe did. And then I also got to perform some wonderful duets with some of the performers, which was so much fun.
Oh, that is so fabulous. And is Unveiled still around out here in Eugene?
Once COVID hit, our last performance was supposed to have been literally 2 days after lockdown started.
Oh, wow.
In March of 2020. And so, we haven't performed since. Spectrum was closed, then it was open, then it closed again because of Delta. I'm not sure where that is, because that was our home, and before that it was the Wayward Lamb, which was our home. And some people have moved on, they've moved out of the area, and so we really don't know what we're going to reconstitute, if even Unveiled will get reconstituted.
Well, I definitely hope it does, because I felt it was very important for us as a community, especially out here in Eugene, to have, you know, that burlesque troupe that was specifically for queer and, you know, allied people, because, you know, I personally as an audience member enjoyed going to those shows because it felt like it was creating a very safe space.
We really tried, and we had a lot of conversations about some numbers and whether things in them might be objectionable, and overall it was just a really great learning experience for me to really get an insight into other people's oppression. Because, I mean, I'm an older, white, cisgender, gay male, and yes, I know what gay oppression is like, but I don't know what trans oppression is like. I don't know what BIPOC, what oppression against BIPOC people is like. I don't know that personally. And so having those conversations really has helped my learning process. And I also think that it's made me realize areas in which I'm privileged, because it can be so easy to focus on the ways that we're oppressed, that we overlook the ways that we're privileged.
Absolutely. And, you know, especially in this day and age where we're at, you know, in society, it's important to address those things. You know, Black lives matter, and even more importantly, Black trans lives matter. We lose people of color almost daily right now, and it's really awful.
Oh, it's heartbreaking, Milena.
Absolutely.
So if Unveiled doesn't get back together, I have an idea of once I'm done with my one-man show, which I'm hoping to do sometime this spring. I would really love to produce a queer variety show,
Oh, I love that.
where we can have a mix of drag performers, burlesque performers, vaudeville performers, musicians, circus performers, but all who have a queer, who are coming from a place of queer sensibility. And, have rotating people. I think that I would really love to see more of that cross-pollination that happens when you bring people from different performing art forms together in one show.
Absolutely. You know, one of my favorite show types are the variety shows because you get such a mix there. And those are some of my most fulfilling shows that I've worked in, is with burlesque performers, sideshow performers, drag queens, drag kings, and all other, performance style. I mean, it is something that's fun to see because it kind of opens your eyes to kind of the tunnel vision that you have as a performer, like being a drag queen. It's like I'm in the drag world. And this gives me a chance to kind of come into your world.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we have had, I have been in some shows with drag performers, and first of all, I have to tell you, Milena, I am just in awe of how much work goes into a drag performance.
Oh my goodness. Tell you, yeah.
Yeah.
It's a lot of work.
Yeah, and it's not just the costumes, it's not just the makeup, it's the rehearsing, it's the rehearsing in heels and being able to do it in heels. It's everything. And I think that one of the things that comes out of that cross-pollination is a mutual respect for each other's art forms. I think you're right, we
Absolutely.
can get a little cocooned in our own little world, and I think it's always wonderful to be able to break out outside our comfort zones and to get exposed to new things.
Oh, I love that. Well, I'm gonna definitely keep my eyes open for this variety show and definitely sign me up, honey, because I'm definitely there. This sounds amazing.
Oh,
Now,
I so would love to have you in it.
Yes. Now you were talking about your one-man show, The Confession of an Aging Twink. I know that you said you haven't been able to premiere it yet. Have you have some hopes in the future maybe to get that going?
I do. Now that Delta is seems like it's truly waning, I'm gonna start looking for a venue, perhaps for a March time frame.
Okay, and what can we expect from this show?
Well, it's a gay musical one-man show. And so I've taken a bunch of parody songs, which are all gay themed, that are drawn from aspects of my life as a queer person coming out, and strung it together with stories from my life. And that's essentially the show. And so it starts from when I was a little kid, from my first musical, Mary Poppins, when I was 4 years old, and takes it all the way to the present day where I turned 60 last year during the
Wait,
pandemic.
what?
Yes.
60? You do not look 60, honey.
Aw, thank you. Thank you. It's good makeup and lighting.
Oh,
No,
well, I just think
I
you're handsome.
yeah, I thank you. And singing about what's next for me in my life. And so it really is. I mean, I don't know if it sounds arrogant to say that it's kind of like the magnum opus of my life's performing work, but who knows? Maybe there'll be another show after that.
Well, I'm going to keep my eyes open and I hope that you definitely get that out there because I'm going to have front row tickets, honey, because this, who doesn't love something with an aging twink in it? Yes. Now, also through the years, you have done some things within our community. I heard you even held a title at one point called Slug Queen. Could you tell me about that?
Yes, well, for those who aren't Eugenians, SLUG is an acronym for Society for the Legitimization of the Ubiquitous Gastropod. And every year for the last 36, 37 years, they have selected a new slug queen who I think of as the unofficial goodwill and countercultural ambassador to the city. And it began as a parody of hometown beauty pageants, and it's now grown up into its own unique Eugenian thing. And if you come to Eugene, second Friday in August, downtown Park Blocks, it's probably the most Eugenian thing that you can do is come to the Slug Queen competition and coronation. And I had the privilege and honor of being 2014 Slug Queen.
Oh my goodness.
Queen Professor Bulbous Slimbledore, a
Oh
slug
my goodness.
wizard.
And now the Slug Queen performances tend to be very artistic. Am I correct?
Oh, there is no typical Slug Queen performance. They range from artistic to comedic to dance, poetry, and of course, for my talent act, for my talent competition, I always done parody songs. And
Oh.
I ran for Slug Queen 5 times before I won.
Oh, wow. What made you keep going for it?
I kept coming up with new ideas and new parody songs that I wanted to do. I almost really didn't care. By the end, I really wanted to win, but along the way, I really just enjoyed competing. And it was just, in a lot of ways, it was just another platform for sharing my parody songs with the world.
Well, Pippin, I only have a couple more questions here, and then we're almost done. You've almost survived.
Oh my gosh, this has been so much fun. I almost hate for it to end.
Oh my goodness. We'll get you in a private video later. So, Pippin, what do you like most about being a performance artist?
I love the connection with the audience. I love, to me, performing is about sharing something. It's about giving something to the audience and to hear back from them. And this is so much why I miss live performing, Milena, is
Right.
that what I love the most, and to me, the biggest high, is to get that immediate feedback from the audience that they are getting, that they're understanding, that they're appreciating what it is that I have to give to them.
Absolutely. It's that connection we get as entertainers with them while we're on stage. And people don't realize, they're like, oh, you can do virtual performances, but that energy that we get from the audience of them screaming and cheering and rooting for us, it's not there. And it really is a disconnect trying to do those virtual performances.
And I have done some kind of more somber numbers that weren't screaming and hooting and hollering, but even in their silence, I just feel their and I can feel their energy, and I just know that they're with me and that they are really getting what it is that I have to offer. And that to me is oh so gratifying.
Absolutely, truly beautiful. Now, Pippin, what's something that maybe us as an average audience may not know about you that we should know?
I in my mundane life, I do social activist work. I currently serve on the Eugene Human Rights Commission,
Okay.
and one of the things that I have been working towards is fighting the rise of white supremacy and white nationalism in the area. I think Oregon has a very racist history, and it still has a lot of people, Proud Boys, and others who would like nothing more but for queer people, BIPOC folk. I'm also Jewish, and the history of my people does not escape me. And to be honest, Milena, it frightens me to see the rise of white supremacy and white nationalism, and even, dare I say, fascism happening in this country. Don't ever think that what happened in 1930s Germany couldn't happen here. We are really teetering on the brink, and if I can do even a small something to help prevent it, then I believe my life will have been worthwhile. And all of the performances pale in the importance of that work.
Absolutely. I mean, if you're absolutely right. We are heading in that same direction of hate and persecution just for being the way you were born. And it's awful. And I think the only way that's ever going to stop is that activism, is getting out there, protesting, holding people accountable for their racism and for, killing people because they're different than you. It's so awful.
And I think that the most important thing is that we have to all be in this together, queer people, BIPOC folk, religious minorities. We all have to be in this together. We have to see an attack against one of us as an attack against all of us. We cannot afford to be in our own little bubbles any longer. We can't just be queer people. We can't just be whatever, because they're coming after all of us, and we need, and I really do believe that together we are stronger, and there are ultimately a lot more of us than there are of them. But
Absolutely.
we have to stick together.
Wow, Pippin, some powerful words there. Just one more question, and what is next for Pippin?
Well, finally doing my one-man show is the next thing for me, at least performance-wise. And then after that, I'll see if I can get this queer variety show.
Well, it definitely sounds like you have some amazing things happening in the future after, we come out of this COVID crisis. But, I can't wait to see what you do, Lyla.
Thank you, Milena.
Absolutely. Well, thank you again for coming on my show and spilling all the tea and just giving us a little background on you.
Oh, it has been my absolute pleasure, Milena.
Well, thank you again. Now, for all of you beautiful boys and girls, and all of those in between, if you're enjoying this fantastic episode of Bitch Talk with Bitchcock, please make sure you're subscribing, sharing, and liking all of these posts. In the meantime, tune in to who we have coming up next. In the meantime, stay beautiful, stay kind, and most of all, subscribe to Bitch Talk with Bitchcock. Bye!
Clownfish, clownfish. Bitchcock, bitchcock, clownfish, clownfish, bitchcock, bitchcock, come and get you, dude.